Welcome again. After a wonderful musical hiatus last Sabbath with Linda Cantu, welcome again to our series of sermons on the steps to Christ. There's 13 chapters in Ellen White's book by this time. I've been using her topics as the outline for these sermons. We're at the 11th sermon today, and its title is Steps to Christ 11, The Privilege of Prayer. I always get a warm feeling when I approach this chapter. It was important in my personal history. When I was a junior at La Sierra College in Southern California, back about 1960, somebody got up the gall to ask me to teach a Sabbath school class. Some committee decided it. I don't know, a committee composed of faculty and students. I've always wondered how it happened because it wasn't logical at the time. And I still, today, am amazed that they asked me. But this incident happened a year later. It was my senior year. I was still teaching Sabbath school classes. And it was a Friday night. And the lesson topic had something to do with prayer. And it was time to get busy because I was going to need to teach in 12 hours or less. It occurred to me that the book Steps to Christ might have something in it about prayer. My roommate had a beat-up old copy which had belonged to his mother in the 1930s when she was a student at the Adventist College in Cologne, Switzerland. I picked it up and found that there was a chapter called The Privilege of Prayer. Now, I'd never read the book before, really sat down and read it. But I'd been in Adventist school since I was 6, and I had heard it quoted a lot. So I sat down at my desk and I started to read. Here were quotes I'd heard all my life, but never read them in context, and they just popped off the page. The book was already 69 years old when I read it that night, but it was alive. I was stunned. I read it again, and a third time, and then still sitting at my desk, I read through the whole book. And I was hooked. I've been reading Ellen White ever since. There's never a time when I don't have one of her books going. When I finish one, I pick up another. About 40 years or so have passed since that Friday night, and the book's age, Steps to Christ, its age is now more than 100. Its language is a little more distant today than it was even in the 1960s, but it still has the ideas and themes that are so right, so deeply Christian, so close to the heart of what really matters in the cosmos. And through the Victorian language, the lightning still flashes. By the way, did you know that this book, Steps to Christ, has been translated into more languages and has had more copies printed than any other book in the world except the Bible? Number one best-selling book in the world except the Bible is Steps to Christ. And I made reference to the age of this book, Steps to Christ. It was published in 1892. In this church family, that's a famous date. What else happened in 1892? That's right. They built this building. The same year that Ellen White published Steps to Christ. So, the privilege of prayer. Prayer is more than meditation. It's good to meditate. It's good to have a quiet time to meditate, to think about God, about the wonderful things He has made, about the things He has given us, His many gifts, His mercies, His blessings. But prayer is more than this. It's important for the Christian not only to meditate about what God has given us, but it's important to talk to God, to have something to say to Him. Go someplace where you won't be disturbed. Sit down or kneel. Imagine that Jesus is sitting there beside you. If he was right there beside you in the next chair, what would you say to Him? How would you talk to Him? That's the way to pray. Would you thank Him for what He's done? Probably. Do you have needs that you would tell Him about? Probably. Are there people in situations that you're worried about that you'd ask Him for advice and help on? Probably. Then do it. Simply and plainly. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God, as to a friend. Would you use pompous and elaborate language talking to a friend? Archaic forms of speech that have gone out of ordinary use today? Is that how you talk to your friend? Would you lecture your friend in stilted religious jargon? Would you adopt some holy sing-song tone? I had a professor in seminary who used to talk about, quote, the holy whine that people sort of drop into when they pray. Is that the way you talk to friends? Prayer is the opening of the heart to God, as to a friend. Talk to them like a friend. Get earnest about it. Get serious. This matters. Tell him the important stuff. You could even talk to him about the little stuff, too. But it matters when you pray about it. Because he is God, and God hears prayers. And he does something about it. So prayer matters. Jesus thought that prayer was important. He took the trouble to teach his disciples how to pray. And he prayed often. He found comfort and joy in talking to his Father. In fact, his human nature made prayer a necessity for him and a privilege. And if Jesus needed to pray, I do too. God loves to bless his children. He loves to give us what we need. He's just waiting for you to ask. He wants to do stuff for you, but he can't always do it if you don't ask for it. Jesus had some things to say about that, and he said them in his characteristic, colorful way. The passage I'd like you to look at is in Luke 11. You want to take Bibles out if you brought them? If not, there's Bibles in the pew racks right ahead of you. Luke, chapter 11. Luke is the third gospel. Matthew, Mark, Luke. After Luke comes John, then the Acts of the Apostles, then the letters of Paul. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke, chapter 11. We're going to start in verse 9. Actually, Jesus started teaching his disciples about prayer in verse 3, but we're starting in verse 9. The reference, by the way, is in your sermon notes. It's a good idea to have your sermon notes out during the sermon. If you miss my announcement of a reference, it's always right there. And maybe more important, I'd love for you to go home, take your sermon notes with you when you go, and read this whole section, what the things Jesus had to say about prayer here. But for now, we're starting in verse 9. Luke 11, 9. Dr. Wong led us in reading these verses a few minutes ago. Ask, and it will be given to you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For all who ask, receive, and whoever searches, finds. And those who knock, have doors opened for them. You who are parents, if your child asks for bread, will you give him a stone? If he asks for a fish, will you give him a snake? Will you give him a scorpion? If he asks for an egg? You're sinful people. But even so, you know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Our Father in heaven, Jesus taught his disciples to pray. For some people, that's difficult language, because they never had a father who was the least bit like God. But Jesus is thinking here of ideal parents, parents like they ought to be. That's the image he wants you to hold on to. How would you like your parents to have been? God is that kind of parent, good and loving, disciplining when necessary, but never cruel or revengeful, never critical or overbearing, healthy, positive, loving, interested, honest. You need that kind of God. In fact, you have that kind of God. What you need to do is get in touch with him, day in and day out. The darkness of the evil one encloses those who neglect to pray. Why should we be so reluctant to pray when prayer is the key in the hand of faith to unlock heaven's storehouses? We have an omnipotent Father. He can do anything he wants, and what he wants to do is give you what's good. Why don't we pray more? It's a mystery. Well, there are some conditions for prayer, some rules. If you want to pray effectively, there's some things you need to know. Let's get them on the table directly. The first requirement is you won't pray effectively unless you feel your need of God. It's those who hunger and thirst after righteousness who will be filled. God promises that He'll pour water on those who are thirsty and floods upon the dry ground. Now, this is not at all about feelings, about feeling needy. It's about principles. It's about recognizing your need. Even if you don't feel needy, you know that you are. So just go to God and tell Him this. God, I really need You. I don't even feel it like I should. And I guess that proves how much I really do need You. God loves people who recognize their need, who admit to it, who are honest about their need for Him. The healthy don't need a doctor, Jesus said. Another time He said, I didn't come for the righteous people. I came to call sinners to repentance. And in the Beatitudes, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Okay, the second rule is to give your life to Him. Give Him your sins. Ask Him to take them away. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord cannot hear me. This doesn't mean that God can't hear sinners. He loves to listen to sinners' prayer. But He can't do anything for unrepentant sinners, those who love their sins, who refuse to let go of them, those who put up a bulwark, a wall between themselves and God by means of sins they hang on to, they love, they cherish, they cling to, and will not let go of them, will not let Him take them away. There's more joy in heaven, Jesus said, over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who think they don't need to. So when you pray, bring your sins to Jesus and leave them there. Ask Him to take them away. Give them up to Him. He can deal with them, and He will. The next rule is to believe, to trust, to have faith. There's a great verse in Mark 11. It's in your sermon notes. You don't need to look it up right now. It's Mark 11, 24. Here's what Jesus says. Listen to me as I read it. So I tell you, whatever things you need when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will. Can you take Jesus at His word here? His assurance is broad and unlimited, and He is faithful. God gives us what we need. He will do it. When we bring our prayers to Him, we might not get exactly what we asked for, but if not, we will get something better. He gives us exactly what we would want for ourselves if we could really see things as they really are. Trust this promise. It means you can bring your request to God and trust Him to do the right thing. We don't know what to pray for. Sometimes we don't ask for the right things. But we can be sure that those prayers are safe with God, and He will answer at His best. God is too wise to err, and He is too good to withhold any good thing from His children. If we indulge our doubts and fears and worries and uncertainties and demand to see everything clearly in our futures before we will act, then our perplexities will only increase. But if we come to God just as we are, helpless and dependent, and simply put our needs in His hands, they're safe there. Those hands hold the cosmos together. Those hands made the world. And those hands were nailed to a cross because they love you. Just trust them. You may not have the feeling that Jesus is bending over you, listening to your prayer in love, but He is. Okay, the next rule is to be forgiving. How can you ask God to forgive you if you won't forgive other people? When you're holding a grudge, you're making a statement. And that statement is, I don't believe in forgiveness. It may be good for other people, but it isn't good in this case. If it isn't right for you to forgive somebody else, why is it the right thing for God to forgive you? Remember what it says in the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Nothing destroys the spirit of a church so much as people who will not let go of their grudges. Nothing destroys your spirit so much as holding on to a grudge. Nothing destroys the spirit of prayer like unforgiveness. I hear lots of excuses for not forgiving, but it was her fault. But he keeps on digging at me. I know his attitude toward me. I can tell it. Jesus prayed for those who crucified him. Just let that stuff go. It may be true. Maybe other people have injured you. You may have a right case, but let it go. It's going to eat you up if you don't. Many years ago, when I was a student at the seminary in Michigan, they assigned me to go out to a little tiny church way out in the Michigan farm country every Sabbath. Kay and I drove out there, pastor this tiny little church, the room, the whole church. No Sabbath school rooms, just one little rectangular building, you know, about the size of the room that the Korean church meets in downstairs. And the people that came there sat in the same seat every Sabbath. I know some of you do that too. But there was a reason. That was because the people that sat on this side of the church didn't speak to people that sat on that side of the church. And this all came from something that happened before I was born. And one day I was sitting in the home of one sister who was one of the principals in this little drama. And she was sort of telling me the story, how all of this had come about. And I said to you, well, did Brother Jones, it's not his name, did Brother Jones ever apologize to you? Did he ever ask your forgiveness? And she said, yeah. I said, what did you do? She said, I forgave the old so-and-so. May have had the words of forgiveness, but she didn't have the spirit of forgiveness. And it's the spirit of forgiveness that this whole thing is all about anyway. Unforgiveness is pure poison. It eats you from the inside. And you will never be able to pray when you're holding a grudge. You simply will not be able to have the spirit of prayer in your heart. Refusal to forgive eats the guts out of your prayers. Doesn't matter how bad the offense was. Doesn't matter how much you think the other person should be punished. And you may be right. Jesus preached and taught and told parables about forgiveness day after day. This was one of the subjects he talked about more than almost any other. And he talked about it so much because he knew how much it mattered. Okay, next. Jesus tells us to be persistent when we pray. Persevere in prayer. Don't just pray once and forget. The Bible tells us to be instant in prayer, to continue in prayer, to watch unto prayer, to pray without ceasing. And Jesus told a parable about it. Once again, you don't need to look it up. Once again, it's in Luke 18. Luke starts this parable by saying, Jesus told them a parable about the need to pray persistently and never give up. And the story is that there was this unjust judge who kept refusing to hear a poor widow's case. But she kept coming back and coming back again. And finally, he said to himself, though I fear neither God nor man, this widow keeps pestering me. I will grant her her request before she drives me crazy. Jesus went on to say that if even a corrupt judge who fears neither God nor man will give a woman her request because she is persistent, how much more will a just and loving God honor your persistence in prayer? Some people feel like it's kind of a lack of faith to pray again for something that you've already prayed for. But God tells us to do it. He tells us to be persistent. There's a rebellion against God in the cosmos. God's locked in conflict with the powers of darkness and of evil. The Bible talks about this a lot. It refers to the principalities and powers, the rulers of the darkness, the spirits of evil in the heavens. And although God's enemies have no scruples whatsoever, God uses no weapons that are not true and honest. He only fights fair. And without our prayers, Satan would be able to say to them, God, what are you doing here? Nobody has invited you here. You're not wanted. They haven't asked you here. What are you doing here? And the more persistent our prayers, the more power God has to act in any given case. It's no wonder that the Bible urges us to be instant in prayer, to continue in prayer, to watch unto prayer, to pray without ceasing. It arms God to do what he wants to do. It gives him freedom to do it. He can say to Satan, I'm here because I'm wanted. My children have invited me, and I will not ignore their pleas. In the words of Zechariah 3, he will say, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. Even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? They are mine. They are mine. I bought them with my life, and I have a right to answer their prayers, and I'm going to do it. Well, there are several different kinds of prayer and several kinds of places where it's important to pray. Now, the most important, if I dare say one kind of prayer is more important than another, the most important one, I think, is what Christians frequently call, quote, secret prayer. Silent, personal communication, going up to God from the individual, heard by nobody else. We can pray silently in our minds and hearts, and God hears us. The Bible tells us that he reads the thoughts and intents of our hearts. So you don't need to pray out loud to be heard. And it's this private communication that is, of all forms of prayer, the most important. The Bible tells us, Jesus' words, as a matter of fact, to pray in our closets. The reference is in your sermon notes. What does that mean? Well, it means to find a secluded spot where you won't be disturbed and pray privately to God. It doesn't have to be out loud, but it needs to be done regularly, daily. Daniel prayed 3 times a day. James, the first leader of the church, had a nickname. It's not found in the Bible. We know this from ancient church history sources. They called him James the Camel-Kneed. Camel knees. Because his knees were so calloused from much prayer. Jesus often spent long hours in prayer. If Jesus needed to pray, you do too. Well, here's a famous quote from the Apostle Paul going on the screen. I'm sure you've heard it. This talks about, I'm sure you've heard this quote. It talks about another important kind of prayer. How can you pray without ceasing? Well, I think the way was well illustrated by a wonderful old medieval monk, whom we know as Brother Lawrence. Brother Lawrence wrote a book called Practicing the Presence of God. And what Lawrence did was to keep up a running, silent conversation with God all day long. He just stayed in dialogue with God all day, silently in his mind. It wasn't formal prayer at all. He just kept talking to God about what he was doing and what he was feeling and thanking God for each little blessing and asking God for guidance or every minor little difficulty. He was practicing the presence of God, treating God as if he was right there all the time, right alongside and in constant open dialogue with us. And the truth is that this is not fantasy. It's exactly what is happening. God is here. He is alongside. And he'd love to be in constant open dialogue with you over everything. This sanctifies the whole life. Brother Lawrence wasn't ashamed to invite God into the little stuff. One of his quotable quotes in his book is this: Lord, make me a saint in scrubbing floors and washing pots and pans. In the dirtiest, grubbiest corners of our life, we can walk in the atmosphere of heaven. Many of us have real struggles contending with the world around us. There are distractions and temptations that intrude and violate our space and crowd into our thoughts. And we don't know how to keep those things out. But remember, it's often best to take a positive approach rather than a negative one. Instead of constantly fighting against the bad stuff that wants to crowd into your head, and trying to force this stuff out, and to hold it out, keep it away. Instead of doing that, try doing something positive instead. Try practicing the presence of God. Try filling your head with good stuff. I remind you again of Jesus' parable. You know the one where a man came home and found a devil in his house? He threw the devil out. He swept the house clean. And he went away on an errand. When he came back, there were seven devils there instead. They found an empty house and moved in. This is a wonderful parable. It makes a very important point. You can't keep your house clean by throwing out the bad stuff. You have to fill it with good stuff instead. This applies to your heart and mind. Don't just try and force the bad stuff out. Put good stuff in it. It was only a couple of weeks ago I told you the cowbird egg story, and I'm going to just briefly summarize it again because it's important and it fits here. The mother cowbird, you remember, doesn't build her own nest. She lays her eggs in the nests of other birds. But the baby cowbird chick hatches first, and it's bigger than the other baby birds, and it hogs all the food, and it starves the other babies out, and it takes over the nest. And soon the parent birds are feeding not their own babies, but the cowbird chick. Well, the presence of God, His love, and His grace in your heart are something like a cowbird egg. First of all, they're from the outside. They're not native to you. Somebody else has put them there. They are not an egg of your own laying. They are foreign to your nature. But second, you don't have to leave them there. It's your choice. You can throw them out at any time. You don't have to let that egg stay there. You don't have to let God's presence live in your mind and heart. You can throw them out. But three, if you leave it there, it will grow and take over and crowd everything else out and rule the nest alone. Practice the presence of God. Don't just pray at church. Don't just pray for a few seconds once or twice a day when you can grab a minute. Take prayer with you everywhere you go. Make it a habit to keep open a conversation with God. Tell Him the big stuff. Tell Him the little stuff too. Make Him a partner in every little task of the day. And slowly, as this becomes a habit, you'll learn what the Bible means when it talks about the beauty of holiness. You'll find your life changing. The bad stuff will melt away. Some of it quicker, some of it much more slowly. But you'll really see changes. And you'll like them. You'll become more and more like Jesus. And being like Jesus is its own reward. You'll find you're no longer trying to be good just in order to get into heaven. You'll find you're being good because you like it. Because that's the way you want to be. Because that's what brings you happiness and fulfillment. Being like Jesus. It's God's Holy Spirit that walks and talks with us. He's the representative of Jesus and the representative of His Father. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will take the good things of mine and give them to you. There are some strange passages in the Bible about the Holy Spirit. In the book of Revelation, the seven lamps in the temple of God, reminiscent of the seven branch candlestick in the tabernacle, temple of God in heaven, seven lamps. And in the book of Revelation, it says they are, quotes, the seven spirits of God. You didn't think of the Holy Spirit as being the seven spirits of God ever, did you? Well, this is leaning on Zechariah in the Old Testament. Zechariah starts out by talking about the seven eyes of God. And then he says these represent the seven spirits of God. Well, obviously, this is symbolic language. Any language about God is symbolic, if it's descriptive like this. Seven, as you well know, seven is, in the Bible, a symbol of completeness, perfection. It means takes the whole thing. Seven is the whole thing. And these seven eyes and seven spirits symbolize that through the Holy Spirit, God is everywhere at once. He is completely present everywhere in everybody's life. He can carry on conversations with each one of us simultaneously. He's capable of some serious multi-tracking, multitasking. Through the Holy Spirit, God is personally with each of us, just as if we were the only person in existence. We can all have His full attention simultaneously. That's a mystery, a paradox, but it's the truth. You can be confident of God's presence with you when you pray. You have his ear. You have his undivided attention. Emmanuel with Jesus' name. God with us. And you can just as well translate it, God with me. Well, next Sabbath, we're going to march on taking steps to Christ. There's only 13 steps in the series, I told you. And we're getting close to the end. Next Sabbath, the title will be Steps to Christ 12, What to Do with God. See you then.